everyone, and welcome to this year's Arts and Literature Fair. Due to COVID, we are not allowed to have an in-person fair, but the school has prepared a worthwhile online operation to allow students, teachers, and families to view certain projects and other classwork that has been completed throughout the year.
For example, I know Rafi's family is very excited to see his target project that he completed last month. I hope you all enjoy the presentations about the students' artwork and literature projects. I would like to give a huge thanks to Mrs. Brothers for helping with planning and making this all possible.
Hello and welcome to the Virtual Arts and Literature Fair. Thank you, Rafi and Sherelle, for that great introduction. Students, now is the time to open your portfolios, take out your bingo board, and get something to write with. When you hear or see something tonight that is listed on your bingo board, write the grade that mentioned it in the box. If you get bingo, put your name on the raffle ticket at the page or at the bottom of the page. Remember, you can also earn a raffle ticket by acting as a docent of your own work after the presentations. Parents, please sign the raffle ticket on the first page to confirm that your child acted as a docent today. To see all of the artwork created by students this year, please check out the school website. Be sure to stay until the very end. We have two special speakers joining us, who are friends with Andy Warhol. I am now going to throw it over to Mrs. Donnelly and Adar, who are introducing the Kindergartners Project.
Welcome to this year's Kindergarten Arts and Literature Fair. This year, the children co-authored and illustrated a book that they'd like to present to you now. Not only are they authors and illustrators, but right now they're going to narrate the book to you, and they practiced using a lot of expression while they're reading. So here they are.
For this project, we learned about the difference between an author and an illustrator. As a class, we were the authors and wrote the story. Then each of us got to be an illustrator and draw the pictures. We hope you enjoy Bernie and the Money Monster.
Once upon a time, there was a dog named Bernie. Bernie could talk. He kept his talents a secret from humans. He was scared that they would think he isn't a real dog.
One day, Bernie was hanging out in his backyard when a man named Steeler jumped over the fence.
Bernie watched Steeler go into his and the neighbor's house.
When Steeler came out, he had stolen the money from both houses.
There was a magic volcano in town, and Steeler believed that if he threw the money into the volcano, he could make a wish. He was going to wish for a money monster to steal everyone's money.
Bernie heard Steeler's plan and ran after him to the volcano.
Steeler threw the money into the volcano just as Steeler was about to say his wish into the volcano. Bernie jumped on him.
Steeler had already wished for a money monster, but Bernie yelled into the volcano for the monster to be a match and to give money to the whole town.
The money monster climbed up out of the volcano. He was ginormous, with money coming out of his whole body.
He picked up Bernie and Steeler. He brought Steeler to jail, and Bernie got to help give money to everyone in town.
They built the money monster a big house, and Bernie lived with him. They got to talk all book time, they lived happily ever after. The end.
Kindergartners, you did a magnificent job with that project. Next, we are going to visit the Caves of Hillel with the first graders. We learned all about the different cave paintings that exist around the world and got to experience what it was like to paint in the dark, just like the people who created those historical artworks. To tell you more, please welcome the first graders.
Welcome to the Caves of Hillel!
If I were in a real cave, it would be hard for me to see and use a lot of colors, and I couldn't use markers because cave painters didn't have them. The caves were made thousands of years ago.
In the Caves of Hillel, I learned that the candle didn't make enough light to paint easily. Cave painters used their hands and some homemade brushes to paint.
I painted my hand for my cave painting. It was super black and dark. In the caves, we painted with fake bamboo, just like the ancient cave painters did. It was disgusting but fun.
I learned that cave painters painted the animals they saw and hunted every day. The painting on the walls are kind of like a shopping list.
It was difficult painting in the dark. I painted a soccer ball.
I learned that the cave painters used different things from the earth to make their paint. My cave painting was of a TV.
My favorite part of cave painting was writing on the walls. My cave painting was of people.
I painted a football because cave painters painted things from their everyday life. I also painted a heart and a dolphin.
My cave painting was about soccer and my name. We only used yellow, brown, orange, and black because those were the only colors the cave painters had.
Cave people use bat poop as paint. I painted my hand and my name. For my project, I painted a hand because I saw it in one of the caves from our virtual tour.
In the caves, it was very dark. It was hard to paint in the cave. I painted a deer, raindrops, and a rainbow. I painted these because cave painters painted things they see every day.
My cave painting was about animals. It was really dark to see one painting by candlelight.
What a great adventure, first grade. Now we have the second graders. They spent a lot of time learning about the Sistine Chapel and Michelangelo. Thanks to Barbara Sobel, we were able to experience what it was like for Michelangelo to paint on a ceiling by candlelight. They created their own ceiling images based on the 12 plagues and the Jews leaving Egypt using chalkboard markers and paint donated by Mrs. Sobel. Here to tell you more are the second graders.
I did boils. I liked it because I got to draw on them. Pharaoh looks great. He's so cool. Michelangelo was a sculptor. He spent 4 years on the Sistine Chapel painting. He had lots of assistants helping. He had a huge ladder, and when he got tired, he could lay down on a wooden plank. While painting, it's cool learning about artists. Michelangelo was a great painter, but he was a sculptor, not a painter. Under the table, it was dark, but each table got two lights. We used chalk markers.
Michelangelo was not raised by his parents. He was raised by stonecutters. I drew darkness. You can only see the head. The other parts are filled with darkness.
I drew legs. We had to draw people. They were made of shapes, and we did it because of Michelangelo. He loved sculpting. The Pope made him paint the 16 chapel ceiling. It took 4 years. We drew the bottom of the tables. It was really hard and it hurt my back, but it was worth it because it was really fun.
Michelangelo was a sculptor who was forced to paint. He painted for 4 years in the Sistine Chapel. I did Locust. It was hard at first, but it got easier and easier. My favorite part of this project was the challenge of drawing the details.
Michelangelo was raised by stonecutters. He liked to sculpt. I drew under the tables. I drew the plague of death to the animals.
Michelangelo loved sculpting the human body. He was really known for making the Sistine Chapel, but he didn't really like to paint. He more liked to sculpt. But the Pope made him paint the Sistine Chapel. Well, anyway, my project was about the 10 plagues, and I did the Plague of Blood.
Michelangelo painted the Sistine Chapel. He grew up with stonecutters. We did the 10 plagues and the Jewish people leaving Egypt. I did the Plague of Frogs.
Michelangelo had amazing paintings, such as the Sistine Chapel. He liked to sculpt better than paint. We tried to make paintings like he did, but we made Torah stories of Passover instead of Bible stories. I did Death of the Firstborn, and it was more realistic because we did it under the table with these special markers. It was really fun pretending that we painted the Sistine Chapel ceiling.
Michelangelo was a famous artist. His favorite thing to do was sculpt. I drew the plague of wild animals. My favorite part was drawing the animals. It was hard because I had to lay back and sometimes the details were tricky. Also, Michelangelo wanted to sculpt, but the Pope commanded him to paint the Sistine Chapel. The Sistine Chapel took 4 years to finish. One fact about Michelangelo is that he lived with stonecutters.
Michelangelo grew up with two people who were not his real parents. Then when he grew up, he painted the Sistine Chapel for 4 years. What I drew for my project was the Jews leaving Egypt. It was really fun and hard because I had to draw all those people in the background. I had a teacher who was really nice and helped me.
Michelangelo was a stonecutter. He lived with stonecutters. Later in his life, Michelangelo painted the Sistine Chapel. The class did the 10 plagues. I did the plague of hail and fire.
What great art historians the second graders are turning into. Next, we have the third graders, who have put a lot of work into creating mythological creatures and headpieces. They used found and recycled objects to make headpieces that represent their own mythological creatures. Acting as bards from ancient Greece, traveling and telling their stories to people in different towns, our third graders are here to present comics of their mythological creatures.
Hello, my name is Gabby. My mythical creature is called a litten. It's a combination of a liger and a kitten. Her power is to breathe fire and can teleport into fires.
Hello, my name is Elon. My mythological creature is called a leviathan. It is a combination of a lion and a dolphin. His power is to breathe fire and shoot ice. Please enjoy our comic. The story of Litten and Leviathan.
This is Lit. I'm very wet.
This is Leviathan. I love swimming.
Ah! Who are you?
I'm Leviathan. Who are you?
I'm Lit.
This is fun. Nope. I found a picture. Let's be best friends.
Good idea.
This is evil Leviathan.
This is evil Lit.
We're finally gonna get them.
I'm the evil Litten.
I'm the evil Lelephant. Brrr.
Okay, that was cool.
I didn't know your power was fire.
I didn't know your power was ice.
3 years later,
we found a house.
The end.
Hello, my name is Alon Spindle. My animals are a puppy and a lion. And I call my mythical beast the Palion. Its power is to turn invisible, and it lives in a very pretty marsh.
Hello, my name is Adam Goffman. My mythical beast is a combination of a garter snake and a horned lizard, and it is called a butt-shooting snake. My animal's power is to float in the air, and its natural power is to shoot blood. It also lives in a marsh.
This is our comic. I hope you enjoy.
The Palion meets the butt-shooting snake.
Once there lived a creature named the Palion that had the power to turn invisible. Hi, I'm the Palion. I have the power to turn invisible. I think I see a blood-shooting snake. One day, the Palion saw a blood-shooting snake, and he was floating.
The Palion decided to attack the blood-shooting snake, and so the fight was on. The fight is on. The Palion bit the snake, and the blood-shooting snake shot his blood at the Palion, and the fight went on for millions of years until they called it a truce.
Ha ha, he hates the blood.
Blood!
They were very tired, so they decided to call it a truce.
Bye-bye, Palion.
Truce.
I'm going to miss the Palion. We hope you enjoy.
Thank you. See you next time.
Hi, my name is Akiva Cohen, and my creature is a hybrid of a blue jay and a puppy. And I call it a blue pod. Oh, and before I forget, my creature's powers are controlling the air and making portals.
My name is Emily Greenberg, and my creature is called a Dolter, and it is a hybrid of an otter and a dolphin.
And this is our story. Hi, I'm a hybrid of a blue jay and a puppy. And I am
a hybrid of a dolphin and an otter.
And you are about to read The Blue Pod and the Dolter. What the heck is that?
What is that weird creature?
I'm going to go down there and see what is going on.
How is that creature controlling the waves?
Hi.
Ah!
Where am I?
My home. Do you want to be friends?
Sure, but what are those?
Sky monkeys, but do you want to go on an adventure?
Yes, but what adventure?
The sky caves.
Okay, because I live there, and I know what to expect. I've never been here.
I thought you said this was your home.
I've been in the sky, but not this place. So we kind of went home, and after that, she told me her power was controlling water, and my power was controlling the air and making portals. Blue Pod's home.
Dolter's home. And they got into a big fight and called each other inappropriate names, and they made up for it.
And they became best friends forever. P.S. They made up for it by falling in a swamp together. The end!
Hello, my name is Ella, and my mythical creature is Swole. It is a combination of a swan and a dove. Its power is to shapeshift into a human.
Hello, my name is Simcha. My mythical creature is called the Galloping Dolphin. It is a combination of a dolphin and a horse. It has the power to fly, be invisible, and shoot water out of its nostrils.
We hope you enjoy our comic,
The Mysterious Forest.
There was once a half-dove, half-swan creature called Swole. The Swole says, "What a pretty day!"
And a half-horse, half-dolphin creature called a Galloping Dolphin. They found each other in the heart of the forest. Where am I?
I was about to say the same that. The two creatures went on a journey together to find their home. My webbed feet are tired.
It's already morning.
Part 2.
Finally, they made it home.
Maybe we can show our power.
Let's go outside and show our power.
I was gonna say that.
Hi! You are a person? The
swove scared the galloping dolphin with her transformation into a human. Cool, you can fly!
I'm sorry that I was scared of you.
It's okay, I know you don't like people.
The end.
By Ella and Simcha.
Hello, my name is Noah. My mythological creature is a North American saber-toothed rhino. It is named Al. He is a combination of a North American lion and a saber-toothed tiger. His power is to transform into anything. He is an albino.
Hello, my name is Ezra. My mythological creature is called a red-tailed sea turtle. It's a combination of red-tailed hawk and a sea turtle. It can naturally swim and fly. My headpiece is still under construction.
We hope you enjoy our comic.
Baby Al makes a friend. One day, Al was in the forest and wanted to go for a swim, and he wanted food and water, too.
I want to swim.
As you can see, they've never encountered each other before.
What are you?
What are you?
He's so small.
He's so big.
And the fight was on.
Well, that ended pretty quick.
Truth.
The end.
Baby Al makes a friend, the prequel. Whoa!
Al transformed into a tiger and attacked the red-tailed sea turtle who was flying by the lake.
Whoa!
The red-tailed sea turtle dive-bombed Al.
But then Al grew and swatted him away.
Tune in next time for the thrilling end to this epic fight.
Hi, I'm Kira Miller. My mythological creature is a combination of an orca and a raven. I call it an orcan. It lives in the water and the sky. Its magical powers are that it can wrap its tail and severe weather will occur. If it flaps its wings, it will create a light that will paralyze other living beings.
Hi, I'm Sarah Moala. My mythological creature is a combination of a dove and a puppy. I call it a dovey. It lives in the sky and ground. Its magical power is that it can lick any creature and it will be poisoned. It's called the poison lick. Here is our comic.
We hope you like it.
Trouble at Mount Olympus. In Mount Olympus,
I hope our guards are doing well.
Meanwhile, oh no, a thief!
Medusa! Zeus is gonna kill us!
The gods hate Medusa.
What is that noise?
I don't know. 10 minutes later,
take her out. Luna, poison lick now!
I know, Molly! Flip your tail now, weather!
Fight, win! You're going to kill me!
10 years later, Medusa is dead!
Yay! And also creepy. The end.
What amazing storytelling by the third grade. Now we have another set of bards in training. The fourth graders also created these collaged headpieces, but have told their stories through animation. Here are the fourth graders.
Hello, my name is Nathan Malam, and for our fourth grade art and STEAM unit, we did a bard theme. A bard is a Roman version of a town crier. In this unit, we created our own mythological creature and did two projects off of it. My creature was called a teagulf and is a mix of an eagle, tiger, and wolf. I made this headpiece from cardboard and wallpaper to represent my creature. And I wrote and animated a myth about my creature. This project, or should I say these projects, are very fun and you should totally do this unit. Please enjoy my animation.
The Tale of the Mythical Teawolf.
Once, in an alternate universe, there was only three animals, eagles, tigers, and wolves, that existed, but soon they would cease to exist. There's constant thunderstorms, and eagles could not fly, and tigers and wolves could not come out of their dens. The situation was getting so dire that they had to start eating their own kind.
One day, the bravest of the brave from each animal tribe came in search for food. They had searched the whole island when they met in the middle, and a huge thunderbolt hit them all, morphing them into one. The morphing gave the animals two powers. The first power is for it to have the brain power of all three animals. The second power is for whatever they think and want to happen. These powers are a very heavy burden, but it brought its kind to an all-animal universe. So, knowing its powers, it hid itself up in the clouds, never to be seen again.
For our STEAM/art project, we made bard helmets of mythological creatures. My creature's name was Spilo. It was a spider and buffalo mixed.
My creature's name was Prandit. It was a rabbit and panda mix. Me and Michael M. made an animation about both of our creatures.
And we hope you enjoy the animation.
What were you doing in a tree?
I was climbing it and I got stuck.
I'm going to use my web powers to get you out.
Okay!
Hello! My name is Mia.
And my name is Leva.
And we made a project about ancient Greece. We made bard helmets, pediments, and a story about our bard creatures. My creature was named Fear. It was a mix between a fox, a deer, and an otter.
My creature was named Ping Bear. It was a mix between a polar bear and a penguin.
We hope you enjoy our animation. Bye!
Once there was a place called the Earth. The water was always running, the animals were always jumping, and the people were always happy. But there was one problem, Ping Bear and Fear. Ping Bear was a mix between a polar bear and a penguin. Fear was a mix between a fox, a deer, and an otter. They were always making trouble. They broke things, they did not listen to the rules, but most of all, they scared people.
It was a beautiful day in Yurst. Fear and Ping Bear were making trouble in the coldest part of Yurst, which was way down in the east. Everyone was relieved that they were gone for a couple of hours. But then, a giant flying bunny landed, and Ping Bear and Fear came out. Everyone asked why they were back at home, and they said the east was way too cold. So, we decided to come back home permanently. That was the day when the people of Yurst decided it was time to take matters into their own hands.
The next day, they all met up at the mayor's house to discuss what to do with Ping Bear and Fear. They were there the whole day. Finally, after
hours and hours, they decided what to do. They would get rid of Ping Bear and Fear. How? Ping Bear and Fear were unstoppable, but they had one weakness.
To be continued!
Hello, my name is Alyssa, and my animal is a deer coon. It's a mix of a deer and a raccoon. Its powers are night vision and super strength.
Hi, I'm Grace, and my animal is a spike. It's a mix of a spider and a cat. Its powers are suction feet and night vision.
We hope you enjoy our animation.
Once upon a time,
There was a spike and a deer coon.
Whee! Whee!
Oh dear, have I interrupted you with something?
No.
Is this your property?
I don't believe so.
Okay.
She's a little odd.
She's odd.
What's your spy number?
122-344-8993.
What's yours?
122-908-765.
Where do you live?
In a magical meadow. Where do you live?
I live in a dusty basement with a guy named Jeff.
Well, hello there.
Hi.
Would you like to come in?
Well, I was hoping we could be friends.
I would love to. Now, if we want to be friends, we better get to know each other.
Okay. I really like black. What's your favorite color?
Blue.
I like having friends.
Me too.
Thanks for being mine.
Hello, my name is Jacob. My partner in this project was Isaac. For our art project, we created mythological creatures. My creature was a combination of a spider and a panda. My creature was a combination of a shark and an alligator. My creature's name was Spando. My creature's power is to give anything a nightmare. And my creature's name was Sharkigator. My creature's power was to eat anything in one bite if I wanted. I hope you like our animation/story.
One day a Sharkigator was swimming down a stream when he saw a spider. The spider gave the Sharkigator a bad nightmare. When the Sharkigator woke up, he heard explosion. Sharkigator found the spider in the cave, and Sharkigator, they went to a bomb shelter and played games on the Xbox/PlayStation/Nintendo Slide Bands. They happily went to heaven at the end.
What funny and exciting stories from the fourth grade. Next up, we have the fifth grade with a music video they wrote and filmed using vocabulary we learned and used in art class this year. A special thank you to Ms. Wolf for helping with the writing and filming of this special project. Please enjoy our interpretation of Under Pressure.
Turn away from the mistakes like a beautiful loops. Sat on a fence like an art master.
Keep running up by the ears, it's a slash and torn.
The sixth graders. This year, the sixth graders wrote a narrative with Miss Wolf. Then, in art class, they learned about how graphic designers have to work with printers to create the front and back covers of a book. Students designed from scratch their book covers, author bios, and a book trailer to get people interested in reading their stories. Please enjoy the sixth graders' book trailers.
Hi, I'm Will Weinstein. And I wrote JJ's Adventure and The Final Battle. I chose to write these books because, one, I enjoy writing and laying all my thoughts into something that I can call my own. Two, is because I want to see what everyone thinks about my stories, hopefully good things, so I can make the best book. I worked really hard on these books, so I hope you read my books and enjoy. Please look out for these two stories at the Hillel School Library.
I made Shrek's Wonderful Journey. I am 12 years old, and I love to play video games. You can read my book at the Hill School Library.
Talia Goldstein, and I am the author of Murdered. I worked very hard on creating this story and the trailer. I am very proud of creating Simone, the main character in this story. I hope you enjoy.
Morgenstern, the author of Change. If you want to read my book, it'll be in the Hillel Community Day School Library. I hope you like my book trailer.
And I'm the author of The Last One. You can check my book out at the Hillel Library. Check out my trailer now!
Hello, my name is Tenny Murphy, and I am the author of Running. I enjoyed writing my book, and I hope that you enjoy reading it. You can find a copy of the book at the Hillel School Library. Here's the trailer.
Gateway. I was inspired to write my story by Joseph Campbell. Joseph Campbell created The Hero's Journey, in which a hero leaves their original world, faces various obstacles, and always emerges victorious. Check out my book at the Law School Library. Enjoy!
My name is Akiva, and I'm in 6th grade. I'm the author of A Weighted Journey. I wrote this book because I like reading fiction books, so why not write one? This book will be coming soon to a library near you.
Anyone who does not like a good laugh should follow the name and don't read this. Other than that, watch it at the Art and Literature Fair. You are about to see a funny and Sababa book trailer. I really enjoyed writing the story and making the trailer. I hope you enjoy it too. Botea bon. Bye!
Like the trailer said, these books are available to borrow from the Hillel Library very soon. Next up is the 7th and 8th graders. They chose to present on an art piece that they felt was most successful this year. Here are the 7th and 8th grade with their amazing artwork.
Hi, I'm Cole, and this year during art class, my classmates and I had to make an art piece based on surrealism. Surrealism was a 20th century art and literature movement which was intended to explore the creativity of the unknown mind. One of the most famous people in this movement was named Salvador Dali, and he was known for his incredibly unique imagination, which he could express through art and more. So I decided to do the same thing, making a criminal floating on a bench in the middle of the ocean with different stages of benches around him, like these two. One of the most unique things in my art piece is the planets orbiting the criminal with incorrect shapes and sizes. This is Saturn, this is the Sun. Throughout my project, I used three different techniques for colored pencils, which were shading, hatching, and variations of pressure. So you might be wondering why I chose this project out of all the others. I did this because I found this one making me the most interested and intrigued out of all the other work we completed, but also due to it being the best of my pieces, in my opinion. While doing this project, there are three main vocabulary words I learned and had to incorporate into this assignment, which were juxtaposition, dislocation, transformation. Thank you.
One of the projects we did this year in art class was on surrealism. One group we learned about was called the Dada, and they largely influenced surrealism. They believed that it was important to embrace their subconsciousness. In class, we learned about how surrealism often shows dreamlike scenes and is inspired by people's subconsciousness. We also learned about Salvador Dali, who was part of the Dada movement and is one of the most famous surrealist artists. We looked at some of his artwork as well as the artwork of several other famous surrealist artists. One of his pieces that I liked was The Persistence of Memory. For my surrealism project, I drew an hourglass with someone stuck inside. In this project, I used watercolor pencils. I used several techniques with them. To create the sand and the hourglass, I used stippling. I also used shading and blending throughout the project, which is clearly invisible in the infinity symbol shadow of the hourglass. I had originally intended to add precious gems to the gold as a play on the expression, time is precious, but in the end I chose not to. I am most proud of how the glass of the hourglass turned out, and the shadowing was also very fun. Thank you.
The project I chose is my spirit animal project. I chose this project since I feel like the concept of a spirit animal related to me, so it was the most meaningful. For this project, we chose an animal that was meaningful to us and focused on a zoomed-in feature of the animal. I chose an owl's face. The techniques I used were scumbling, blending in the colors with my fingers, stippling, and using texture sheets. I chose this for a more realistic texture. I used mainly stippling and scumbling for the center of the brown to get the look of the feathers. I made looser circles with the scumbling and I blended out some of the brown on the outside as well. I used some blending from yellow to white for the beak. If I were to recreate this project, I would add in more detail. I am especially proud of how I used the techniques and really enjoyed learning them.
Hello, this is my surrealism project. It is based on many things, and they all symbolize something that has important meanings. My art project depicts a night sky with three planets, a floating shoe, a disembodied head, and free-floating fire. The floating shoe in the top right quadrant symbolizes possessions and money. The floating head in the top half symbolizes thinking, time, and speech. The floating fire in the center symbolizes mind and soul. The planets are there for additional color to remind the viewer that the objects are in outer space. The first rendition of the painting did not meet my standards, and I wasn't happy with it. I painted over it because in art, you can erase your mistakes, not everything is permanent. It is inspired by The Persistence of Memory by Salvador Dali, a famous surrealism artist from Europe. It also was based on the show Don't Hug Me, I'm Scared, a famous web show that was based on surrealism films from the 1900s. It took a while to make it look good, but I like it. It ended up taking me 7 art classes to finish. I learned you should be proud in your work, and if you are not, work on it until you are satisfied.
For this video, I decided to talk about my surrealism painting. I chose this project because I think this one looks the nicest, is the best overall drawing idea, and I enjoyed myself the most while making this project. This project is something I just made. I let my imagination run wild to the point where I don't know what I've made. Actually, that's not entirely true. For a long time, I've thought about trying to make an odd creature, but odd doesn't really emphasize the level of strange that I wanted, but it's the closest I can get. It is a watercolor painting, I used multiple techniques to make it. The techniques I used were wet on wet when you use a wet paintbrush on a wet surface, wet on dry when you use a wet paintbrush on a dry surface, and dry on dry when you use a nearly dry paintbrush on a dry surface. Some of the parts I used wet on wet were the skin of the creature, these purple parts, and I also used it on a portion of the blue background, right here. With dry on dry, I did some of the finer details, like the eyes of the eye of the creature, this little pentagon over here, and also the flowers. With wet on dry, I did the bird's head, the teeth of the creature over here, and most of the blue background. In class, we talked about Salvador Dali, a famous surrealist artist, whose antics I wouldn't recommend. This painting right here mainly used transformation. For example, the person's head turning into a tea kettle, and its hands turning into a ship, and legs turning into two different things.
One of my favorite projects that I did in art class this year was the Surrealism project. Surrealism is when things are odd or out of the ordinary, and for this project I chose to give a couch human aspect. I used acrylic paint as a medium and painted an ordinary red couch with blue human-like eyes. I also used a technique called wet on wet by putting down two wet layers of paint and then blending them with a paintbrush. This technique was especially useful when I added black paint to create a shadow effect, which added dimensions as you can see on the cushions and on the arm. The surrealism quality I used was dislocation, which is when something is out of place or somewhere it shouldn't be, as you can see with the eyes on the top of the couch. My project shows dislocation because I put eyes on the couch, which is an irregular place for eyes to be, and my inspiration for this project came from when I saw a picture that had human aspects on furniture. The artist that inspired me was Salvador Dali. Salvador Dali, who was a surreal artist from Spain, was one of the most influential artists in the surrealism movement. Thank you.
Hi, my name is Reza Glazer, and I'm going to be telling you all a little bit about my independent study project. For this, we use the art style of surrealism. Surrealism focuses on using our unconscious mind and involves art that doesn't look normal and isn't exactly hyper-realistic. For my project, I designed my piece to look dreamlike by blurring the sides, as you can see here. I use symbolism for my objects in the middle as well. For example, the sand timers in the middle of my painting represent time running out, and the doors represent rejection. So you can see the sand timers are here and the doors are up here. One of the main qualities of surrealism is using dislocation, which is placing objects where they shouldn't or wouldn't normally be. I use this for all my objects, the road, timer, and doors. In class, we learned about a very famous surrealist artist who went by the name of Salvador Dali. He was an influential part of the surrealism movement and created many popular paintings such as The Persistence of Memory. This painting is the one that is known for its clocks and use of dislocation. I chose this project because I feel that I was able to express emotions that I usually find difficult to in an art class. I was able to transfer the themes from one of my meaningful dreams into a painting, and I also just really like the way that it looks and how it turned out. I also used the elements of art while making this project. I based my composition off both the compound curve and the circular types. This is because while there was a narrow strip surrounded by two sides, as you can see here, it was more circular than just a normal curve. I also heavily focused on texture by blending my paint colors on the side together to add the shading effect, as you can see with the blues. This makes the texture look very smooth. I also used a color pattern of cooler colors, including blue, silver, and navy. This effect makes most of the project monochromatic. Due to the oppressive nature of the sides of my painting, the focal point is in the middle, where all the floating objects are. I do this by making these colors darker than the ones on the outside. Some other techniques I use were scumbling and color gradients for the smoke on the sides of the painting. Scumbling is when you overlap different colors until they shade together, and color gradients is when you apply two colors that go well together in a painting and mix them so they shade together as well. I also use the dot technique for my background and for the sand and sand timers. As you can see, there's like little dots in the sand timers. Thank you guys for watching.
Hello, I'm Elijah Yar, and the art piece that I would like to present is my close-up of a toucan. As toucans are very vibrantly colored creatures, it can be challenging to transfer their colors to paper, especially using pastels. I was largely focused on layering colors to get the right mixes to match the reference photo I was using. For example, the light on one part of the beak brings out a bluish undertone in this black portion of the bird. And that was difficult to recreate. In other words, my technical work was mostly color matching. The focus of the piece is the eye and the beak, as the colors are most intense there. The artist we researched for this project was Georgia O'Keeffe, most famous for her close-up paintings of flowers, on which this project was based. And I chose to present this particular project because it honestly seems to be my best work for this year.
Hi, my name is Itai Weinstein, and I'm in the 8th grade. Today I'd like to talk about my painting. This is a surrealist painting made of acrylic paint. It's meant to be a half-man, half-squid hybrid. His mouth is surrounded by tentacles, and his eye has been removed from his socket. But he's bleeding blue blood, but not red, as that's the color of squid blood. His dislocated eye is in his mouth, and he's surrounded by the light blue ocean background with teal-colored bubbles as in his background. In this artwork, I was experimenting with color mixing. For example, I mixed the colors blue and white to make a light blue, light ocean-colored background. I mixed white, orange, and brown to make a muddy, flesh sandy skin tone for my character, but it's underwater. Some elements of my art that I used in my piece include shape, space, composition, and color. I used shape to clearly define the face and the facial features, as well as the bubbles in my background. I used space to give everything in my piece a cohesive, realistic, and finished look that fits together nicely, whether that be the face and the facial features or the ocean background. I used composition to make my piece pleasing to the eye and to direct the eye to where my focal point was, which is the face. I used color to accurately reflect the objects I was painting. The artist that my class learned about was Salvador Dali. Salvador Dali wasn't the first surrealist artist, but he took the surrealist art movement to the mainstream in the US and Europe, validating it among the artist community that it was an important artistic movement. I chose to share this project because I enjoyed using acrylic paint and feel like it is a good surrealist piece and a good example of color mixing. Thank you.
Oh, hello, my name is Sharma Mori. I am an 8th grade student in Hello Community Day School. The project that I chose to speak about tonight is one of the best projects I have made throughout my Hillel experience. This project was called The Spirit Animal. We had to pick an animal of our choice and zoom on the part of that animal. For example, I chose a killer whale, and I zoomed into the part of with the little of the eye and some of the white spots near the eye. I chose this part because it had many colors you might not see. Killer whales are black and white, but I would also use yellow, blue, and a little red for the shading. If I had only used black, we would not see the shading, and it would not look realistic. As you can see on the top and bottom left quadrant, you see the shading in the white and how it blends in with the black. For the white color, I had used a combination of yellow and white on the white spots. Over here, you can see it. If I do this again, I would be more careful to stay in the lines and not drag the black to the white area, because the black made the white areas look appear dirty. My inspiration for this project was Georgia O'Keeffe. She was an American artist. She is known for her enlarged flowers, New York skyscrapers, and New Mexico landscapes. Georgia was a teaching assistant for art. She taught in the University of Virginia. Thank you for watching.
My name is Ari Spicconi, and I chose to present my work from my spray paint unit. This was one of our first units in the year, and is probably my favorite. I completed 4 pieces during this project, and today I will be showing you 2 of them. I started spray painting this past summer and learned that one of the most common themes that spray paint artists do is space. I chose to incorporate a space theme as well because it looks cool and it's pretty easy to learn. For this unit, we were not only supposed to use spray paint, but we also had to make our own stencil. This piece specifically features a tree stencil, which you can see down below. I made it with the idea of something floating through space. The 2 main techniques I used in these pieces were texture and contrast. The place where texture was needed most is in the upper right quadrant where the planet is, as you can see here, which creates the texture and the lighting. The most common way to do this, and the way I did it, was to layer black and white on top of each other multiple times. Eventually, when you build up enough layers, you can take a plastic bag or a crinkled newspaper to lay over and then rip off. This then gives the effect of a rocky surface, just like the moon. When creating this type of texture, it is called implied texture, and it is when you give the viewer an impression of a real texture using other elements of art. Another advantage of creating a planet is to create a focal point, which draws the viewer's eye in. For contrast, I primarily used black and white. When I first started spray painting, I thought that these colors would be lame to use because they are not exciting and they seem pretty limiting. However, after doing it for a little while, I came to notice that they contrast well and are pleasing to the eye. A good example of this is in the upper left quadrant, where I created multiple white lines intersecting next to the moon, as you can see here. In my opinion, this gives off the effect of a star and acts as a nice light source for the painting. Thank you so much for listening, and I hope you enjoyed.
Hello, my name is Hubie Hirschfield. The project that I chose to talk about tonight is our independent study project. The reason I chose to talk about this project was because I am most proud of this project, and I put a lot of time and effort into learning the techniques to make this. This project had three different parts, and they were all related to our theme of this unit, which was surrealism. Surrealism is an art movement which artists, poets, and writers all took part in. Salvador Dali was a big part of this movement. He was a Spanish painter and a printmaker. We also learned about and discussed some of his pieces, like The Persistence of Memory, which is very famous. The artwork and other pieces of literature were made in such a way so that the art wouldn't look like something typical or from everyday life. The artwork would look like a dream. I chose to make a self-portrait, but instead of there just being a brain for the person, I made it look like what a brain looks like under the skin. Around the open brain were different struggles that I think about in life, like money, family, love, and death. They were each placed in different quadrants of the canvas to symbolize what is going on in different places in my brain. One of the techniques that I used was a subtractive technique on the brain to remove the wet paint to outline the brain. Another technique I used to give a realistic look to the skin was stippling, as you can see here with the skin tone. For the rest of the parts of the painting, I used wet on wet to give it that watercolor look. In the end though, I don't think I used enough water because it doesn't really look like watercolor. I really liked how this project turned out, and I think that next time I should practice those techniques more before painting on my final. Thank you. Have a good night.
Hi, I'm Rafi. I'm in 8th grade and telling you about one piece of artwork that I did this year. The project I'm picking is my surrealism project. After World War I, there was a surrealism movement, and artists during that time are well known because of their disjointed and surreal artwork. One of the most famous surrealists was Salvador Dali, who is known for his artworks that have juxtaposition and dislocation in them. The project I did, shown here, is my surrealism project. As you can see, it is not ordinary. On the right side, you can see an oddly shaped door that has a person missing a limb in it. On the left side, there's a huge square that has the limb holding onto a piece of rope in the shaded abyss. I used charcoal to make this, and have shaded a big portion of the picture to add more effects of light and dark. I decided to share this project with all of you because I like it the most. It being drawn with charcoal, and because of how you can use charcoal, I think it gives a cool effect. I used compressed charcoal, blending stumps, and erasers to make this. Thank you.
Thank you to all the students, teachers, faculty, and parents who put so much work into making this happen. To close out our Arts and Literature Fair, we have two special guest speakers. Here is Henry Levine to introduce them.
Hi, I am Henry Levine. Here is our interview about Andy Warhol with my great aunt and uncle, Katie Dobbs and Fred Newman.
Did you ever see Andy Warhol's studio?
The studio?
Yes, we were lucky to. Do you remember the name of the studio when you studied him? It's got a special name. It's called The Factory. And The Factory moved several times. And we saw the last factory because we didn't meet Mr. Warhol till 1981. So we only knew him the last 6 years of his life. But the factory was a business office, and his painting studio moved into the factory, and they had wonderful lunches, and people would come to
get their portraits done, and it was a lively, interesting place.
But it was a place to stamp out art. He was making it. He was using the art with all the different images on it. He was making it with silk screen.
And in the fourth grade, you can read this book about. See, by fourth grade, you could read Factory Made. This is all about the factory.
And he, unlike other artists, he called it a factory. And he said, you know, I'm going to charge you a lot of money and I'm going to call this art and you're going to buy it from me. And people did.
Because it was good art.
It was amazing.
Did he need glasses or did he wear them because they were cool?
I think, he wore glasses like this. Almost
Ray-Bans,
all the time.
Ray-Bans.
Ray-Bans. He wore them all the time. I think, one, he was shy. He didn't want to make eye contact with strangers and so forth. But I think even more is that he was a watcher. He loved watching people more than anything. People talking, people interacting, people shaking hands, people in restaurants, celebrities, whatever.
Clothing.
But when you put on sunglasses, watch this. Look, I'm looking at you. No, I'm not. I'm looking over there. You can't tell where that someone's eyes are. So he could put on sunglasses and he could look at anyone and stare at people and sort of take it in. That's what he did. He loved that sort of thing.
What was your favorite wig that he wore?
Wigs.
Well, when we knew him, it was pretty much the same. It kind of pew on the top, you know, lots of hair up here he went bald very young, and he was blonde and went bald very young. And it was just sort of a wild head of hair. And the thing about the wig is that whenever he was anywhere, you could find him, kind of like finding Fred in a crowd, because the white hair stood out. So it pretty much looked the same to me. I was at a book signing with him once. My best friend, who we got to know Andy through my best friend, he asked me to go with Andy to a book signing to be with him. And some woman in line whipped his wig off. it was pretty shocking. And he had on a jacket that had a little hood, and he unzipped the hood and put it up, tied it, and kept signing books. And I thought he had tremendous poise, and people were freaking out, but he just kept going and covered up his head, and there went the wig.
I think it was about managing his celebrity.
Yeah.
That he was always looked the same. And I don't know how many wigs he had. They always looked the same to me. And he always wore something black or dark, or like a turtleneck like this. He would wear that all the time. So he didn't have to dress up in different ways or try to impress people. One last thing of that is that because I was born with this color hair, my hair was always this white, it was just really weird, that he called me his stunt double. And he has sometimes, I never did this for him, but he had people put on a wig and go in as him if he had to speak at some place, and they would speak for him and they would know it's not Andy, but they called him Andy and everything. He just pretended. So he said, you could be my stunt. I said, no, I don't want to.
Well, people thought Fred was a relative too. So that was
two white-headed guys at a table with the same kind of hair.
Where did you meet Andy Warhol?
I met him first, my best friend at grad school at Harvard. We moved to New York together with a bunch of other people moved to New York. And he got to know Andy, and we were very, very good friends. So he started, there would be places where my friend and he would be together. And then I started dating Fred, and we became dinner partners and had good times together and a lot of fun. And it was a nice chemistry between the four of us. For some reason, we laughed. The thing about Andy is he may look like a cartoon character, but he was very curious, and he went to college. He went to Carnegie Mellon. It wasn't, he was serious about being an artist and making his way in the world, and tremendously curious and interesting about the world, about what was going on in the world. So he was fun to know. He was really fun to know.
who, when I first met him, with Katie, and I'm pretty sure it was a dinner.
I think it was my, you gave me a 31st birthday party, and I think he came to that with John.
Oh, that makes sense. That could be, I think, but it feels like it's over dinner somewhere.
Yeah.
But what I found is I was quite scared of, because I didn't know his image at all. I mean, I only knew his image, and I didn't know him, but he was very soft-spoken, and he was very, hey, that's great. And he said the word, that's great, all the time. Everything amazed him, and little things, and he would go, that's so great. And I think, can't remember exactly the setting, but we got along because he was curious. And I was curious, and Katie is not one to be shy. And if the conversation lulls, Katie's on top of it. And I'll tell a story. So I think we got along the way I'm going on really long on this question, I'm just keeping talking. That's what we did at Conversation Lab. So we liked that.
What was your favorite painting that Andy made?
Well, I have a visual. There's this wonderful two-part book that I like a lot that comes in this little case. And it's Andy's early illustrations. And here's his kitty. I love his original black ink watercolor. And then I think you studied that, here's a great kitty. Isn't that a great kitty? But his mother was his original, like this writing here, that was his mother. His mother was a brilliant
calligrapher.
Couldn't get the word out. And she was in New York we didn't meet her, but she was in New York till the late 60s. And I think she died in 1970.
It's hard to call what he did paintings. They are paintings, but his early work, he was a commercial illustrator. And so he drew some of his early drawings, and I was amazed at a museum we saw recently. He did something called ink block printing. He would trace things, turn the paper over with trace with ink.
Print them on a new piece of paper.
Yeah, that's exactly right.
And then he would choose his two best, and then he would put them on the market to sell, and it would make them more valuable.
That's exactly right. So he did drawings. He went from drawing into, he did painting watercolors and things, and then he started doing silk screens where he could manufacture. And that's when he did the factory and so forth. So he moved from there. So he was just marketing images like a commercial meaning like a business. He did it like a business, but people said that's art, and it was part of pop art.
It was a great vision.
It was an amazing vision. Yeah. And he still has this influence. We're doing this Zoom now because his influence is so felt.
At his museum in Pittsburgh, which is the largest single museum dedicated to one artist, largest museum dedicated to one artist in the world, is all his early work from Carnegie Mellon. And he did beautiful paintings of interiors and images of vistas and trees. And so, like many, many artists, they start out learning technique and how to be a good artist and how to use their eye. And then they figure out what they want to do and they go that way. But he studied technique and he studied art and he learned how to be a really, really good artist.
Do you know what of Andy's artworks were his favorite?
I think my feeling is that it's the portraits, because he really liked being around people. He loved famous people. I mean, that's why he started Interview Magazine, because he got to go to all the parties and meet all the famous people. The portraits had people come to the factory and hang out, and he became friends with people. I think my feeling is that the portraits held a special place for him.
Yeah. Yeah. But then he went on to do like endangered species and do a lot of different periods of things. he was restless in that way, but I think that all there were ways, he was kind of quality. Gee, that's great. That he wanted, if he was interested in this, he would go into that, but celebrity was always there around there. Yeah.
Did Andy blush a lot when you knew him like he did as a kid?
Did Andy blush a lot? He was so, like me, very pale. He was very pale.
He wasn't an albino. Sometimes you read he was an albino. No, he wasn't an albino.
But he was very, very pale. I never saw him blush, but he would put his hand up to his mouth. And there was a story I told, I'm not going to tell the story, but it involved throwing up on a bus. And we were in a restaurant, this restaurant called Cafe Luxembourg, and Andy started laughing so hard that, I mean, his eyes widened, and he took his napkin and shoved it in his mouth. So he was that shy that he wouldn't go just laugh out loud, and he would hold it up. But I didn't see him blush.
When the wig got pulled off, which would have been a big moment for having a blush come up. He was very in the moment and controlled, and how do I fix this? And I don't remember seeing color.
Yeah, you know, yeah. I never saw him move fast. He was always, now we only knew him the last sort of 8-10 years of his life. Actually
81 to 87.
Okay, there you go. So he was I don't think reacting to something, he was slow to react. He would sort of nod and so forth. Quick blush is not what he did. The one, I have something that I found, and really Andy was one of the people that led me there. The other was Jim Henson. And we one time
Jim is.
Jim Henson is the guy who does
the Muppets.
Oh, there, Kermit the Frog here, we got Jim Henson to dinner with Andy Warhol, and but each wanted to meet each other. And they're sitting across the table, and Jim Henson's going, "Oh, that's wonderful. That's lovely." And Andy's going, "Great." And I'm looking at them, and I'm really, they're just two kids.
Yeah.
They kept their creativity. And what I've known in my what I found from that. And then born out in my life is that if I can't see the kid in somebody, they're not that special to me. I want to see the kid. Someone who is so, looked like armored, like black and the glasses and all that, you take the glasses off, it's just a kid. And it's just the world was something vulnerable and wonderful. And he was a quiet man, same with Jim Henson doing, talking all through his hand like this. Talking like that. Come on there, Kermit the Frog here. They were just kids, and I think that kids don't want to be kids. They want to be grown ups. They want to be older. No, kid, this is where it's at. Everybody wants to be you. Keep that.
Yeah, I just like to say that we knew Andy during a really probably the first couple decades at the factory with the movie making and all this, we weren't part of that scene. We got to know the person Andy through other people. It was a personal relationship, and then got to see him in action at the factory and doing art. But I was surprised how he's so generous. He was generous with everybody. He was really kind. He threw beautiful dinner parties and loved decorating, and he had a beautiful townhouse, a great eye. He liked to have people around and share it with. So my memories of him as a friend is he was a really good friend. He was extremely kind and generous, and always interested in what our careers were doing. He put us both in his magazine, ha ha ha. So those are good memories. But also, he was a serious artist. He was a serious artist, and he worked hard at his art. And he was this little kid from, outside Pittsburgh, who who really had talent and made it happen for himself. And you have to admire that. Well, I got to go to the townhouse a couple times. He had two dachshunds, which Amos and Andy, and I love them. And they were great little dogs. And he had a 5-story townhouse on the east side of New York. And it was just, he had rooms filled with, he loved to go to you know, antique stores. And he had certain, he loved candlesticks for some reason. I remember seeing the candlestick room. But he also had collections in the building, in his home, that were arranged in different ways. He would get on a Jag with something he wanted, and then he would buy a lot of that, and it was stored in his apartment.
He gave a lot of it away. Yeah. When we got engaged, he gave us a gross of engagement rings that were off, like from downtown, somewhere downtown. They were all little cheap engagement rings, all on a board. They were like 2 dozen on a, you could break them off and you could open them up. He gave me for what Christmas? I think it was about, yeah, it was this. This is a box of elephants. They're probably 30 or 40 elephants. And this is a beautiful one, an antique one. He gave me elephants.
But he must have been somewhere and he just bought the whole box of elephants and then he decided not to do it all.
He gave us some very, very funny, beautiful sort of collections of things. He was always buying stuff and putting boxes and he would give you one. I should go get those. I do have he gave me his teeth one Christmas.
Teeth
cast in aluminum. His dentist, I think it was a dentist that had cast his teeth in aluminum and given it to him, and he signed it MC Warhol. So I'm guessing there's not many of those around.
Andy loved packaging and commercial packaging and advertising. He came from that era, and he used to walk around with these in the side carryall that he had, a little canvas bag, and he would sign eggs, these sheer energy egg things, and hand them out. And people go, why this? And he said, they're cool. So I have a signature. And now they're gone. You can't get these anymore, thank goodness. But so here's his signature on an egg package.
Because my hair was like his, he gave me, I forget how many, like 500 or 600 combs that you break off in a store, that a plastic thing.
He loved packaging.
And so that he just loved stuff, multiples of anything, like his prints. He loved all that stuff. But when you go in a store and you see displays of things, he would buy whole displays. Right. Say, I want all of those.
Well, it's sort of like one doesn't stand out, 10 of something. It makes art,
it does work with his factory, with the multiple images of Marilyn Monroe,
with his advertising
and about, you know, yeah. So it's like film, the multiple images that make film and so forth.
Yes.
Yeah.
Thank you so much, Katie and Fred, for taking the time to speak with us today. Thank you to everyone who helped make this happen. And students, don't forget to hand in your raffle tickets tomorrow morning. Go and enjoy being docent.